Herbert Baumeister, an American serial killer, would bait gay men to his pool house and then brutally kill them and bury them in his backyard.
Before we get into the details, here's a clip of Herbert where he found a dead raccoon and decided to take Polaroid pictures of it. While taking pictures of a dead raccoon may seem odd, I was more captivated about how normal he looks. But if it's one thing that I learned from this case, it's that looks can be deceiving.
Happened.
Right by striping, you know, whatever.
Herb Baumeister of Carmel saw it all.
I said to my son, they're gonna hit that raccoon with a spray gun, and sure enough, they just striped right over its face and neck. You know, didn't even move it, you know, no effort to, you know, get it out of the way.
Welcome to Truth, Fiction, and More, where I cover bone-chilling true crime and fictional stories. Herbert Richard Baumeister was born in Indianapolis on April 7, 1947. He was the oldest child to his three other siblings. While his early childhood was fairly normal, it didn't last for too long. It was allegedly reported that there were multiple incidents that showed mental health issues and antisocial behavior at a young age. He had an odd fascination with dead animals, and eventually his father took him to a psychiatric for some unknown time period. This is where he was diagnosed with schizophrenia and multiple personality disorder. And for those of you who don't know, it is a chronic brain disorder that can include symptoms such as delusions, hallucinations, disorganized speech, and more. In 1965, Herbert enrolled himself in the Indiana University, where he would study for only one semester and return in 1967. The reasons for his temporary dropout are unknown, but are thought-provoking. He would later attend Butler University, where he would drop out before finishing his education. He would later get a job as a clerk at the Bureau of Motor Vehicles, where his colleagues recalled many odd situations. For example, he urinated on his boss's desk and would have random tantrums. He then had a fairly successful career as he held many jobs and even founded two Save-A-Lot thrift stores in Indianapolis. In 1971, Herbert married Juliana Sater. This marriage of 25 years would result in three children. By all accounts, the family was normal and your friendly next-door neighbors. They would go on to purchase a multi-million dollar house in Westfield. During summer, the family would vacation in their family-owned condo near a lake. The family was well known in their community for their charitable donations to the ones in need. It was alleged that during the day, Herbert would run his business as would any other successful business owner and spend time with his family. Later at night, however, he would go to gay bars to prey on young gay men. From 1990 to 1995, a community was deeply suffering. Gay men had started disappearing in Indianapolis. Unfortunately, disappearances were not widely covered by mainstream media, so people didn't really know about this. Victims would fit in similar demographics, as in height, weight, and age. Roger Goodlett, a young gay man, left his mother's house to go to a gay bar. However, he was never seen again. After a while, Roger's friend Mark had an odd interaction with a man named Brian Smart. Mark had gone to a gay club in Indianapolis, where a missing poster for Roger Goodlett was posted. Brian Smart was looking at the poster for a long sum of time, and Mark had a strange sense from the way Brian was viewing the poster. Brian Smart later approached Mark as a landscaper from Ohio who was in Indianapolis for work purposes. Brian Smart then invited Mark to a house where he was temporarily staying. He told Mark that the house had a pool and they could go for a swim for as long as they liked. Mark and Brian both left for the house, which happened to be Fox Hollow Farms, Herbert's house. Oddly enough, Mark noted that there was an in-ground pool surrounded by mannequins. Herbert told Mark that he gets sexual gratification when he is being choked. He asked Mark to choke him with a pool hose, while he masturbated. After he finished, Brian asked to do the same to Mark, and Mark played along. However, Brian did not let go, even though it was clear that if he didn't let go, Mark would die. Mark then pretended to faint and go unconscious. Eventually, when Mark got up, Brian acted as if he was worried about Mark. Brian then drove Mark back to Indianapolis. After this very terrifying evening, Mark immediately told the police about it. Now, unfortunately, Mark could not recall the license plate number or the exact area of the Fox Follow Farms. And therefore, this tip did not get anywhere for about 2 more years until Mark saw Brian Smart again. And he immediately noticed his license plate and went to the police. And when the police ran his license plate, the car belonged to no other than Herb Baumeister. It was alleged that this is the tip that would prove to be the best tip for catching the serial killer. And it wasn't just the police that got a big lead on this case. In 1994, 13-year-old Eric Baumeister, Herbert's son, was playing in the woods on the family's property. The teenager came across a hard-looking ball, which he later identified as a human skull. Eric rushed it home to show his mother his discovery, and soon after, Julie and Eric both returned to the same location, only to find more bones on their property. When Julie brought this matter to her husband, he brushed it off swiftly. He advised her that they were from a medical school skeleton that apparently belonged to his father. He didn't want to keep it at his home, so he had thrown it in the farm. Julie never asked him for further explanation. However, as a result of his growing bizarre actions, Juliana filed for divorce. Now, going back to the tip that the police received, Herbert had become a clear suspect. The police requested Herbert for a search of his multi-million-dollar house, which was refused by Herbert. When Herbert was on vacation, it was a great chance for the investigators to conduct a search on his 18-acre property. The FBI file was released under the Freedom of Information Act. However, I went through it and majority of the information is not legible. The file, however, states that the search was conducted under a consent of search, but it doesn't clarify if Herbert or only Juliana provided the consent, or whether it was consent of the legislative authority, such as a local court. Anyways, FBI cadaver dogs Alex and Max took the lead in finding the remains of 11 men on Herbert's property. There were other 9 bodies of men found in the nearby areas during the same timeline. These bodies were along the corridor of Interstate 70, also known as I-7. Herbert was the suspect for all of these bodies due to the similar manner these bodies were harmed. When Baumeister discovered that his arrest warrant was active and out, he quickly fled to Ontario, a province in Canada, where he committed suicide on July 3, 1996. While he did write a suicide note for his family, he never confessed nor mentioned anything about the murders. It is unfortunate that he died before a fair trial to get information for his victims and their families. We will never know why he did it and whether he had others helping him. Now, this is the end of the stories, and I would like to thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this type of content, I truly hope you can subscribe and like my videos, as it tells me that people are enjoying my content. Once again, thank you, and I appreciate your support.